the highlights and lowlights from the first awards show of a new era. We've asked a lot of Oprah Winfrey over the years. She's given us a lot in return. So, at the dawn of a new year following a really difficult one marked by horror and some rays of hard-won hope, we summoned her again, asking her to clarify and inspire and give us some kind of moral direction. As ever, she delivered. Accepting the Hollywood Foreign Press Association's Cecile B. DeMille Award at the Golden Globe Awards tonight, Winfrey gave a long and impassioned speech about women standing up against patriarchy, citing Recy Taylor and Rosa Parks, her own mother, and the many women who have recently spoken out about the UAL harassment and abuse they've suffered in Hollywood and beyond. It was exactly the kind of rousing, rumbling oratory the evening needed. As the first big awards show in the post-Weinstein reckoning era, the Globes were a bit of a test case to see how Hollywood could celebrate itself while also acknowledging its many institutional ills, overlooked and abetted for so long. Reflected in the Globes' mission tonight was a blurry vision of the rest of society, or at least the portion of society that cares and is paying attention to all this. What do we do now that it's harder to ignore these problems, to minimize them into whispered anecdotes with no real weight of consequence? Well, Winfrey offered something of a way through, clad in black like most of the women at the Globes tonight, telling the patriarchy, or at least outwardly abusive men, for the time being, that time was up. It was a benediction and a rallying cry and, some half-jokingly hoped, maybe an early stump speech. It was so good that it kind of felt like there didn't need to be anything else. Followed immediately, "Why Not Go to Commercial After Oprah NBC," by Natalie Portman, presenting Best Director, pointedly noting that all the nominees were men, with a Greta Gerwig. Winfrey's head moment was so seismic and decisive and on target that the rest of the show felt lacking, superfluous. And some of the results proved disappointing. Most of the women winners, most prominently among them Nicole Kidman and Laura Dern for their performances in Big Little Lies, and Reese Witherspoon for her producing, spoke about the issues at hand when up on stage, many of them having brought women's rights advocates who work outside of the film industry with them to the show, as a sign of solidarity and support. But the men were largely, dismayingly, unsurprisingly quiet about the movement, and the list of winners, especially in the film categories, seemed a bit ignorant of the realities pressing down on the ceremony and upon the rest of the country. The trenchant, vital Get Out was only nominated in two categories, and it lost both. Daniel Kaluuya was denied Best Actor in a Musical, a Comedy in favor of James Franco in The Disaster Artist, a perfectly pleasant real-life showbiz fable that felt entirely less necessary than Get Out, and Kaluuya's urgent central performance. Get Out also fell short in the Best Musical, a Comedy category to Lady Bird, which was a worthy opponent. But an awards ceremony honoring 2017 films that doesn't give anything to Get Out, a critical and commercial hit of piercing relevance, and doesn't even nominate Jordan Peele's screenplay or his sterling debut, Direction, is not an awards ceremony that can be wholly saved to deliver by an Oprah sermon, however great it was. Awards shows aren't required to be anything but what they are. There's an argument to be made that it's silly to ask these voting bodies, especially the HFPA, which is relatively tiny, to act as cultural correctors, to redress systemic wrongs. And certainly, yes, we should not be relying on the Globes or the Oscars to do much, if any, societal repair. But then we get back around to the matter of visibility, and all this starts to feel important, just a little important, again. When art, by sheer dint of its existence, can, at its best, genuinely function as a tool of ennoblement, of resistance, as a bulwark against the noxious ooze pouring out of Washington, it's frustrating to watch same old practices played out in the face of obvious opportunity to do something better. Maybe I'm just mad that three billboards outside Ebbing, Missouri won a whopping four awards. The film star, Frances McDormand, good old, or irascible, sensible, straight-talking Frances McDormand, wasn't a disheartening win. But to then see Sam Rockwell's Racist with a Heart of Gold character rewarded, and writer-director Martin McDonagh's seriously spotty screenplay win, and then the whole thing take Best Drama. That was unpleasant. Three Billboards certainly has its fans, but from a lot of angles, a straight white male's sneaky apologia for his kind is not really the for this particular moment. Or broadly, are awards shows right for the moment, either? I'm not sure. The obvious highlights of Sunday's broadcast aside, the Globes this year had trouble making much of a case for themselves. Host Seth Meyers did a fine job with a tricky assignment, one that probably shouldn't have been given to him. He joked that no women wanted the job, but how sincere was that? A gag about how he has no power in Hollywood fell flat because it's, well, absolutely not true. While a bit with Amy Poehler in The Aunts just made me want Meyers and Poehler to switch places. Meyers seemed to know that he maybe wasn't the most worthy ambassador for the community just now, but there was also something smug in that knowing. He still agreed to do it, didn't he? Interestingly, Meyers was really the only person to heavily mention Donald Trump throughout the night, though the president's stink still hung heavy in the air. He is, after all, essentially concomitant with all this talk of harassment, abuse, and other aggressive displays of male power leveraged against women, so perhaps there was no need to say his name outright. Maybe that was its own kind of statement, not giving him the satisfaction. He wasn't watching anyway, he was too busy sharing a New York Post writer's email address in a now-deleted tweet. But still, there was maybe some power, some bit of protest, in not calling him by his name. We've got the Screen Actors Guild Awards in a couple of weeks, and then the Oscar nominations, and then the weeks-long wait for the big show. It's impossible to say what will have changed between now and then. But if the Globes were any indication, awards season is going to have a strange, charged, existentially troubled tone this year, which it almost certainly should. How the tone is grappled with, how it's addressed in ways both concrete and abstract, will be the real test of the industry's self-regard. Tonight's show was a decent enough first foray into a new enlightenment, I suppose. Sure, ES Red Carpet Special was excruciating to watch, whiplashing terribly from genuinely exciting interviews with real-life activists standing alongside stars to witless mundanity, garishly worthless and out of step. Again, the men were too quiet, from Franco to Gary Oldman, whose own past is already being re-evaluated. And some of the HFPA's choices were bad. But hey, there was still Sterling K. Brown's strong speech after winning for Best TV Drama Actor, a first for a black actor in the category. There was still splendidly prickly Natalie Portman, still Tracy Ellis Ross in a fabulous Durban, still Rita Moreno riding around on a rascal. And, of course, there was Oprah. Thank heavens there is Oprah, reminding us how nice it is to hear the right words, delivered in the right tone, at the right time. When so many of us are feeling so off, it's awfully heartening to know that, hey, Oprah's still on.